disappointed that what he was trying to do, nobody understood it at the moment. And of course, in those days particularly, it was very difficult. If you were in, you were in. He had this new thing, and it was difficult to get anybody to understand or try and do this.
If anyone has got any doubt that it could be wrong to try something out of the ordinary, how do you account for things that are happening now? And you can even look back in the past. It's a case of being more lenient or more patient until one is sure what is happening in the present.
Voice of Joe Harriott himself, and before that, his bassist Coleridge Goode and percussionist and singer Frank Holder. Joe was born in Kingston, Jamaica, in July 1928. From the time he came to Britain, aged just 23, he began notching up remarkable achievements in the jazz world. He was a frequent poll winner as best saxophonist in the country. He became a pioneer of world jazz with Indo jazz fusions and the guitarist Amancio Da Silva. He helped fuse jazz and poetry, but he's most remembered for finding a different route to freedom in jazz from Ornette Coleman's. Joe himself wrote, "The music has already experienced all the possible harmonic variations and permutations. This is a period of embellishment, but to accept this fact is apparently a fence over which few are prepared to step. We, in our small way, are trying to make this stride."
This form of music, we're not using any particular set harmonic structure. We're attempting to paint sound, colors, and effects for this sort of music.
This is Impression, from Joe's first album entirely in this style called Freeform, from 1960. Frank Holder remembers how it came about.
He came up with the idea, he said, "Frank, look, I want to try this thing, and I want to call it Freeform." He used to speak rather like that, you know. Freeform, we have no bar lines, you know what I mean? And we sort of fell in quite easily, Coleridge and myself, with this. And it gave the musician a scope to just play and not be restricted.
Thank you. So what was different about what Joe was doing and the music Ornette was making with his first quartet in Los Angeles? Bassist Gary Crosby has studied Joe and his music, and I wondered if he thought Ornette had influenced Joe in any way.
Harriott was, I wouldn't say an egotist, but apart from Charlie Parker, I don't think he'd give anybody else the time of day. He would possibly listen to them, but I don't think he was influenced at all by Ornette Coleman.
Ornette is playing solo with bass accompaniment. He started with piano but discarded that and then had just a bass accompanying him, which is okay. But this was meant to be a group effort, which is something completely different.
Coleridge Goode.
It involved a more harmonic approach. One had to get that right. Anyway, after some rehearsals, I began to get ideas, because with Shake and Pat Smythe especially, was wonderful on the piano. Things just sort of naturally seemed to happen because we were all in a similar frame of mind and thought what were the possibilities, and we could play our instruments well enough to use these ideas that came to us. So it worked.
Joe seems to have sprung onto the British music scene as a complete musician, ready to tackle anyone and everyone who came into his musical path. But how had he got there? What was his musical background in Jamaica? I asked Gary Crosby about Joe's childhood at Alpha Boys School.
I was told by a great trumpeter, Eddie Thornton, who went to the school, that even at school, Harriott was a cut above everybody else. He put it in his tan way, you know. Mr. Harriott is a snob. He called him a snob. And when I asked him to explain it, his view of it was that Harriott was an intellect from the beginning. Apparently a very good mathematician as well. There's nobody that knew him, got to him that close in his teenage. He seemed to be like he had created this wall around himself. There's nothing written about his teenage years as such. There are pictures of him with McNear in the Alpha School band. Nobody seems to have much information about his family background or anything like that. And even people like Mr. Bradshaw, who would have been his first mentor, very little is spoken about his private life. It's very mystical, isn't it?
There is one person who can shed a bit of light on this early period of Joe's life. Alan Robertson, author of Joe's biography, Fire in His Soul.
Because Joe was brought up in an orphanage, he developed an inner strength against the loneliness that he must have felt being separated from family. His own brother didn't join Alpha Boys School until some years later. And by that time, Joe had become something of an island in the way he reacted with people. And so much so, his brother said, if you ever wanted to find Joe, you just listen for the music. Started on the clarinet and progressed to saxophone.
Why was he actually sent to an orphanage?
He had three siblings born at two-yearly intervals. He was the first child, and the youngest of them, Velma, assured me that her mother died some 2 weeks after Velma's birth. They just didn't have the funds to look after the whole family of four themselves, so the decision was taken early on that Joe and his brother Ivan would be taken into care by the Sisters of Mercy.
Were the Sisters of Mercy responsible for his basic music schooling?
they had a regime there that was pretty strict. Joe's daughter told me that Joe managed to get through Alpha Boys School pretty well unscathed as regards corporal punishment because he was such a talented musician and didn't really see any advantage in trying to run away as Ivan did. Ivan tried to escape and was returned, whereas Joe realised that the best way for an easy life was to crack on with the music.
Given its, you know, proximity to America, given the fact that there was this quite strong community, why do you think Harriott chose to come to England?
You would think that life would have been a lot more inviting for a jazz musician in the States, but I think Joe had this idea that he would probably fare better in Britain. After all, the American scene was very, very rich in talented musicians, and perhaps Joe thought, I could really knock them dead if I go to England, because he certainly did when he arrived.
This is one of the bands Joe worked with within a couple of years of his arrival in the UK, Tony Kinsey's quartet.
We needed a new frontline player, and I'd played around one or two of the clubs, you know, a few jam sessions, particularly at the Star Club, which was Rick Gunnell's club in Wardour Street, and I'd first heard Joe and played with him there, and I thought what a great player he was, and so we asked him if he would join. He said yes, and it went on from there. Joe was a gentleman. He believed in presenting himself in the best way he possibly could. And so did we all in those days when we were playing, you know. No such thing as rolled up shirt sleeves. So we bought these sports jackets and trousers from Smart Brothers in Shaftesbury Avenue. And we had these rather nice ties, silver with a red streak in them. And it was a very pleasant uniform to wear, yes. We got this booking at the Salle Playel at the Paris Jazz Festival, and the French fans in those days had a reputation of booing anything pretty well that wasn't American, you know, in the jazz sense. And we sort of arrived there, and we played opposite Jerry Mulligan and Bobby Brookmeyer. We all felt a little nervous about how the reception was going to be, particularly after following that group. And then we went on the stand to our surprise. They loved us and cheered and shouted for more. You know, I think we only had about 40 minutes to play. And that was a tremendous experience for us all. And at the time, there were a few jazz clubs in Paris. And we were there two or three days. And we spent our evenings playing and sitting in those places. It was delightful, really. A picture of Joe having a long chat with Thelonious Monk, and oddly enough, Thelonious is seen laughing. They were sharing some sort of joke, I don't know what it was. We did integrate quite a bit, yes.
Tony Kinsey's quartet, with Bill Lesage on vibes, Sammy Stokes on bass, and Tony on drums, with Joe, of course, on alto saxophone. On returning from Paris, Joe began to record for the Esquire label, privately owned by Carlo Kramer.
He had this rather lovely flat in Bedford Street off Tottenham Court Road, and down below was this recording studio.
I always remember, because we were recording straight onto vinyl, you know, through the glass partition, Carlo would be behind and you get the red light and off you go and you watch the arm come down onto the vinyl, you see. And these vinyl discs were quite expensive, I gather, at the time. And we get to the end of the recording and I'd say, oh, can we do it again? I'd like to do one more. Nope, you'd say. I think it was because of the cost of these acetates. But it was nerve-wracking because you couldn't edit anything in those days. You just had to do it.
By 1958, Joe decided that he was ready to think about leading a band of his own. Coleridge Goode was playing with Alan Clare when Joe turned up to sit in.
It was Bobby or myself and Alan Clare playing. And then Joe started to play. And of course, there was that wonderful sound and the marvelous fluency and so on. It was very enjoyable. And then after we'd finished, Joe spoke to me and said, he was thinking of forming a band. Would I join him in the band? Well, of course, I jumped at the opportunity. And he also invited Bobby to join the band. That was the beginning, really, of the Joe Harriott group. Our first engagement was in Frankfurt, Germany.
Thank you.
Jumping with Joe, from the Harriott Quintet's EP, Blue Harriott, which featured almost the same lineup that went to Germany, except that Bobby Orr, who appears on the record, had been replaced for the tour by Benny Goodman, a well-known London drummer. The piece was written by the band's pianist, Harry South, and the trumpeter in the lineup was Hank Shaw. In due course, this was the band that would pioneer Joe's ideas about freeform, although there's little sign of it on this early record. But Coleridge Goode asserts that Joe was already thinking about his next steps.
It was actually on the way to this gig in Frankfurt that he first mentioned it to me. He sort of murmured about it before, but nobody took it very sort of seriously.
Did Joe's state of health ever cause you any problems?
Yes. In 58, I think it was. Well, not all that long after we'd started. He had lung problems, pleurisy or something like that. And he had to go away to hospital for some weeks. Of course, it's a very serious thing to have that sort of problem when you're playing a blowing instrument, especially.
Shake Keane was to replace Hank Shaw, whom we heard on that last record, as the band's trumpeter. Shake would become a key partner in Joe's search for freedom, and he met Joe during this period of illness, as Mike Garrick recalls.
Shake was working for the Caribbean Service of the BBC, and he was interviewing West Indian musicians. And Joe was on his list, but because Joe went to hospital with pleurisy or something, he went to see him in hospital. And whether this was their first meeting, I'm not sure, but I know that that was the connection, or at least that's what Shake mentions in another interview, where he began talking to Joe about freeform.
It is free, in the sense that the artist involved is free to create, play patterns, sounds, effects, and so forth. He can utilize all the known set patterns of chordal structures and rhythms and so forth, but it's his choice, and that's why it's free. He's not bound to toe the line as we know it.
This is Pictures, one of the remarkable tracks cut by Joe's quintet on its 1961-62 album, Abstract, the successor of the album Freeform, which we heard at the start of the programme. How does Joe's biographer, Alan Robertson, feel about these very significant records?
I took a long time to get round to hearing the quintet because the music hadn't been reissued since the 60s and nobody I knew had any copies of it. And it was only reading Ian Carr's Music Outside book on the difficulties of life in British jazz in the 70s that I knew of the quintet's existence. I knew of Joe only through Indo Jazz Fusions. So when I finally heard them, I was absolutely blown away and I thought, this is just fantastic music. The 40 years or so that have passed since its recording, and it sounds as fresh today as it must have done then. Maybe not as revolutionary as it did then, but it was so exciting, and the quality of the musicianship was just astounding. And of course I found out that two of the members of the quintet were Scots, Bobby Orr, the great drummer, and Pat Smythe from my own hometown of Edinburgh was the pianist. Now Pat had a fantastically delicate touch. So I loved them. I heard Shake Keane's flugelhorn and trumpet. Fantastic sound, fantastic. I mean, Kenny Wheeler, for me, is one of the greatest, but Shake Keane was up there with him. And Phil Seaman, when he played with Joe, a most astounding character, just an incredible drummer, the best drummer in Britain, time after time when they had the Melody Maker Awards. Yeah, what a band. And if I've, you know, missed anyone out, as I have with Coleridge, Coleridge was just there the whole time. Coleridge was an innovator himself. He had a wonderful, wonderful background in swing jazz, going right back to the early days. And he was the rock, I suppose, in the band. He was such a stable and positive influence.
Joe Harriott Quintet from Abstract, one of their most celebrated freeform albums. In the next program, I'll be looking further at this aspect of Joe's work, but also at his collaborations with players as different as Chris Barber and Amancio Da Silva, and his pioneering world music with Indo-Jazz fusion. But for now, from me, Soweto Kinch, goodbye.
And the final part of the Joe Harriott story can be heard at the same time next week. It was produced for BBC Radio 3 by Alan Shipton for Unique, the production company. BBC Radio 3, 6 o'clock. Now, as part of Black History Month, the final part of the Joe Harriott story. Soweto Kinch profiles the musical career of the Jamaican-born alto saxophonist Harriott, who pioneered free jazz in Britain in the late 1950s.
Hello, I'm Soweto Kinch, with more about one of the most visionary and remarkable musicians on the British jazz scene, Joe Harriott. This is Joe's own quintet, with trumpeter Shake Keane, pianist Pat Smythe, drummer Phil Seaman, and bassist Coleridge Goode. Pianist Michael Garrick got to know Joe as he worked opposite the Harriott Quintet at the Marquee Club off Oxford Street. They became good friends, and this, in turn, led to a new departure for them both.
It coincided with the emergence of the poetry and jazz concerts, which were organised by Jeremy Robson. But he, at that time, this is the very beginning of the 60s, was working with Danny Absey and Laurie Lee and Spike Milligan, and putting together poetry with jazz from a different direction. I had also started the same thing, only using pre-existing poems, whereas he was using the poets themselves, reading their own stuff. All this came together in a kind of bunch around about 1961, 62. Jeremy heard a show that we did at the South Bank, asked me if I would write for his show. Ours was just a one-off, you see. It wasn't anything more than that. But he had a series lined up, organised under the umbrella of Arnold Wesker's Centre 42. And he wanted a quartet, and I thought I'd ask Shake. Shake was marvellous. And then, it's wonderful to be able to say things like this, but there was a bit more money to spare for the band, so we asked Joe as well. So then we had a quintet working. And by 1963, the Argo Record Company was sufficiently interested to mount a live performance in their Hampstead studios and record the whole thing.
Now the birds begin to crow. It is the time for them to grow. Below them, hurrying cars have almost reached their destinations. The crowded trains shrug slowly from the stations. Soon they will be gone. Only gaping stars, lonely and unwatched, guard the sleeping city. The branches chatter in the breeze. The grass softens under the falling dew.
Playing bass in Michael Garrick's quintet was Coleridge Goode.
For some, there is sleep.
Michael was very adept at writing music to these poems, which fitted the bill, as it were. It inspired one to try and put some expression which would fit in with what the poet had said. It worked most of the time very well.
You get a picture from Joe's interest in fine arts as well as music and these intellectual pursuits with Mike Garrick and poetry, that it's somebody who's not just concerned with alto playing or not just concerned with a narrow definition of jazz.
Yeah.
Would you say that affected you as well?
One had to be attentive to what the reader was reading and let that influence your playing, kind of thing, because it's supposed to be an enhancement of what was coming out from the reader.
Can you hear the thunder? Can you hear the thunder? My love cascading towards you in a torrent of hope. Chases over sun-drugged streets of midday, over frost-stung fields of midnight to breathe beneath your window. Can you hear it now? Perhaps the tone is too high or the words too long. Or perhaps the rain or pain has washed it away. Don't go. Listen, listen. Let me try my song again. Can you hear the thunder? Can you hear the thunder?
Cascade. The Michael Garrick Quintet with Jeremy Robson and Ian Carr taking over the trumpet chair from Shake Keane. Joe's own quintet worked in a similar collaborative spirit to the way these players extended and complemented the work of the poets. Joe's biographer, Alan Robertson.
I suppose even in the quintet, when they were all improvising, all of those occasions were pretty collaborative too. I don't believe that the music ever stayed stagnant any time. It was different every time he played, just the starting theme and the closing theme.
As I discovered from Coleridge Goode, these themes had almost the same function in Joe's freeform pieces as the poems did in Mike Garrick's work.
The theme was quite important because it should set your mind working in a certain way. It should suggest something to you. And as Joe put it, it's like painting. You have your idea of a scene and you play according to what the scene suggests to you.
Joe was tremendously interested and affected by Picasso and works of visual art. Did he introduce those interests into the group as well?
Yes, indeed. Again, I mean, the important thing was to be able, almost instantly, if you have an idea, to play it, to be able to put it in play, you know. We were all pretty good at this. It worked very, very well.
Modal is one of the most memorable tracks on Abstract. How did that come about?
I was hoping you would ask me that. Well, at the end of our recording of our first LP, the guys started to pack up, and Pat was doodling on the piano, and Phil, we just finished playing a very fast thing called Tempo, and he was virtually out, you know, he was really tired, really exhausted. But anyway, while Pat was doodling, he took his cowbell off. He was standing up, and he was tinkling this cowbell. And, of course, it has a note. And Pat went into the key of the note and started playing in that key. And also, Shake was walking about the studio. He had a glass in his hand, and I think it was brandy. He always drank brandy. And he had a pencil. And he pinged this glass. And miracles of miracles, it was an octave above the cowbell. Now, such a thing, how often would such a thing happen? And immediately, I felt that we should try to play something on this theme, the way that this all happened. So the microphones were still on, and I called up to the recording engineer. I said, run a tape, we're going to play something. And we were off. And we just played. Then, while we were playing, Joe, who had been up in the recording box to listen to the playback, came down and joined us. And Shake then also joined in. And Modal was born, just out of thin air.
Modal comes from Joe's album Abstract, part of which was recorded in 1961. This was a year when, as Alan Robertson explains, Joe was involved in a very different style of music, although it had some elements in common with his freeform work.
Chris Barber had it right when he said he thought the New Orleans kind of freedom, where each player can set off on his own soaring solo whenever they choose, as long as the rest are amenable to it, he said that setting, a lot of people thought Joe would not thrive in at all. He says, but I'm sure he did. And Joe used to really enjoy those gigs that he did with Chris Barber's band. And you only have to listen to Swonderful, where he's playing with an inspired Ian Wheeler on clarinet, to hear the pair of them firing ideas at each other. And it's just, the interchange is just superb. Joe's very much playing what he wants to play, and Ian Wheeler the same. And yet they meet beautifully in that highly charged live atmosphere at the London Palladium.
Thank you.
it was a pole winners concert, and we'd won the traditional jazz side of the pole. And so here we were on the concert, and the editor of Jazz News, Brian Nichols at the time, introduced us, and so on and so forth. And we said we wanted to have Joe as a guest, and he was also a pole winner, I think, in Jazz News. Although we had played with him before that, that was the first time we did it under fire, shall we say, in a serious concert. And it was great. Him and Ian Wither playing, it's wonderful together, it's absolutely brilliant. The great thing with Joe playing with us, when we played kind of a New Orleans thing, like a spiritual or something, you know, in a march style, he would join in with that. Sometimes if you get a modern player that sits in with a traditional band and you're playing an ensemble, well, you all improvise at once, but you interrelate and you communicate. It's like a conversation full of bits and pieces. And the modern player will stand there waiting for a space to play in, you see, to be his own thing, you see. Whereas we all know, you just start up, you hear the others play, you join in, you get in the conversation and you anticipate somebody else's ideas. It all works, even though you can argue that logically it shouldn't, but it does. And Joe just joined in and played with it. It was great.
Joe's famous record with your band was Revival.
Yes.
But although he's on the live LP, I found he's not on the single.
What happened was, the live version, which is great on the concert, was about 8 minutes long, you see. Then EMI got onto it and said, oh, we're getting dealer requests for a single of that. They said, will you please record a single length version of it? Now, if I had actually been as bolshy as some people in the business complained I was, I'd have said, put it out as it is and call it a single, you know, on a 45. 45s, I know they'll take 8 minutes because they're called EPs with 8 minutes on each side, you see. So why not? But they thought we want a single length, so we had to go and cut another one. And Joe wasn't available that week. So we recorded it best we could without him.
Not long after this foray into traditional jazz, Joe began working with Anglo-Indian violinist and composer John Mayer in the Indo-Jazz Fusion's double quintet, which included the five members of Joe's regular band, plus five Indian players. Did Coleridge Goode rate this experience a success?
I suppose it depends on what culture you come from, really. From the British point of view, it would seem a little bit strange. Perhaps not so much from the Indian point of view. From my point of view, for instance, the music starts with what's called a raga. And my job was to play nothing but this raga right the way through, so the other instruments should play according to where it was in the raga and so on. It's a little bit involved, really. It's difficult for Western musicians to improvise on these time signatures. So it didn't always come off as it should, I suppose, to thinking of the Indian musicians and Indians, because they're used to these odd time signatures.
Let's say more Western people know more about Indian music now than they did, say, when I started the band about 20, 30 years ago. In the old days, Joe didn't know anything about the ragas, neither did any of the rest. I think the only one who knew something about the ragas was Pat Smythe. The linear structure of Indian music, as you know, the raga, has a certain ascending and a certain descending line. And I tell many people that the technique of raga music in India is similar to the serial technique of the West. The only difference is serial technique is atonal, the raga music is tonal. What I mean by the strictness of the serial is that a raga goes up in one way and comes down another way. And you have to stick strictly to the ascending, which is the arohana, and the descending, which is the avrohana. You have to stick strictly to these. Because, as you know, there are many ragas in India which have the same notes, but it's the ascending and descending structure which determines one raga from the other.
The voice of the late John Mayer. This is Indo Jazz Fusion's most famous recording, Mishra Blues. Joe followed up Indo Jazz Fusions with a remarkable and now much sought-after record in which she worked with Amancio da Silva, a guitarist from Goa. Some critics suggest this was a climb down for Joe artistically because he wasn't playing his own music.
Amancio's album, I suppose, was all penned by Amancio. It may well have been seen to compromise his own freedom of expression, but that Joe had a tendency, I suppose, to express himself wherever he was. Sometimes I think his best work, some of his most challenging and really searching material, was in duets.
The mid-1960s was the point that perhaps Joe might have decided to improve his lot by moving to the United States and following the lights of Tubby Hayes or Victor Feldman. But as Gary Crosby says, Joe had managed all his attainments so far quite independently of America.
The fact that he was an Afro-Caribbean of Jamaican background, not of Black American background, and he still reached to that level of technical and artistic supremacy, I think that I like, and that makes me feel comfortable, you know what I mean? And that statement he's made about not having to go to America to become a great musician, I think that's quite important.
I also have a pet hate that one couldn't think for oneself unless one emigrated to a place like the United States. Because whether one goes to the States or live in the jungle, one can think. And it's just a matter that, well, one live in a Western world and one agrees that, well, there is a standard here as opposed to somewhere else. And this, I think, has not necessarily helped people to be more inventive. They look to a place for a guide. Now, this can be unfortunate, but if one is a little more lenient towards it, and if in some cases one is able to stand back and look at the situation, one could be easily encouraged to think for oneself. There shouldn't be one place leading the thinking public, or the musicians, or aspiring artists. Unfortunately, I find, I hope I'm wrong about this, that jazz musicians, American and otherwise, seem to think that, well, one could only be a good musician by being in the United States. And I'm sure there's a lot of very bad musicians there, like any other place. It's not their place, it's you.
Despite Joe's pet hate, he was finding that getting work for his quintet was no longer as easy as it had been.
It was getting harder and harder because his free form wasn't really popular out with London. I just think he's finding it really difficult to manage a band, so he took to playing solo, just appearing along with resident bands and pubs and clubs all over the country.
Playing at Harry Flick's Jazz Club in Leicester, with drummer Tony Levin, plus Fred Barnsley, bass, and Colin Willits on piano. Joe was starting a slow decline, as one friend discovered after Joe had stayed the night with him and was setting off for his next gig.
When he went out the door, Clem said, "Where's your saxophone?" And he says, "It's in the left luggage." He left his sax in the left luggage at the railway station. I mean, what a thought, that he didn't even have a secure place to keep his saxophone other than a locker in a railway station. I found it very moving when I got to that part of his life when I was researching it, and I just heard how isolated he was by his circumstances. And again, some of it may have been his own fault, but you can't help but feel sorry for him.
In 1967, Joe made the last recording with his own quintet. Suffering from continued health problems, including a tumour on his spine, Joe lived another 6 years after this recording, dying on the 2nd of January 1973. But in his short life, he was just 44 years old, he proved you don't have to be American to change the course of jazz. Today, we are just beginning to recognise the full depth and breadth of his legacy.
He wanted to be recognised as a great artist, there's no doubt about that. He may not have received that full recognition, but he would have been respected, equivalent to the sort of respect that we all give to an older musician who's been there, seen it, done it, and still capable of creative ideas.
The feeling towards him was generally very, very positive, and the people I spoke to, they say, one after another, you know, "I just wish he was here today, you know, I still can remember him." One lady, Marilyn Layton, told me, she said, "I can't remember my own brother's faces. They've been dead some time now, and I can't remember their faces clearly, but I can still picture Joe's face, because he was just so adored by people." Thank you.
Cheese.